I'm going to get that championship back by shaking hands, being best friends with the champion. No, I slapped him right in his stupid face. I slid out of the ring, and I let him know my intentions from that point.
He calls me down to ringside, and we're starting to chat. He's just seeing how I'm doing, all that. And then at the very end, he's like, "Hey, you got a match." I was like, "I'm sorry, what?" He's like, "Yeah, you're going to have a match." I was like, "That's not normal. Like, why? And he's like, you'll be fine. You're going to do good. You're going to wrestle Aleister Black. It's going to be great." I was like, "All right, cool. Yeah."
And now, your hosts of the Card Subject to Change podcast, for frequency's sake, tag team champions of the world, the Wizard CZ and Never Wrong Ned Bull.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another exciting episode of the Card Subject to Change podcast, episode 114. If you joined us the other night for the late show, episode 113, we broke down WrestleMania night one. Tonight, it's Shank-A-Mania. We have back with us Brandon the Shank Eubanks. But before we talk to Brandon, I'm going to introduce you to my co-host, the Wizard CZ. Wiz, how you doing?
I'm feeling magical, baby. We're talking WrestleMania.
WrestleMania was magical, as I cannot wait to break down here. We're going to break down night two of WrestleMania and the Raw after Mania. Of course, tonight is our Shank-A-Mania night two and Raw spectacular. And it wouldn't be Shank-A-Mania without our special guest, absolute pro wrestling's own, Brandon the Shank Eubanks. Shank, how you doing, buddy?
Dude. Yeah, right? I get so excited every time. I don't know why. My favorite is when I do it and I see all the little kids. Because my favorite thing is they miss, like, this is how we do it. Because it's the Shank, right? So I was the Shank. This is all I did. And then you got Bryce Jordan, the Golden God. So you put them together, you got the boys. So these kids.
I started doing it because I seen you doing it. I'm like, well, that's what he wants to do. That's what we're going to do for the picture.
Kids, hell yeah. Kids do this. They'll do just a pinky. They'll, like, put their two fingers. I'm like, hey, whatever. Turn them to yourself. We're cool with it. Whatever you got to do, man. Whatever you got to do. God, I love those kids, man. That's my favorite part of it.
Before we break down night two, Shank, can we get your quick thoughts on night one and what you thought of that?
Sucked. I hate to say it. I did not like night one compared to night two. If we're being honest. I did not like that. Did not like the main event. Maybe I was like, why are we wasting steps here? We all know what's about to happen. Like, why are we wasting steps? Let's just move on. Let's go to tomorrow. Like, when him and Roman grabbed each other, I'm like, why? You remember when Raw wouldn't let two do this? It'd be a tag match. And we were all sitting there like, come on, just tag them both in. Tag him, but you don't want to fight Triple H. Just tag him in. And then they touched. And I was like, oh, man, I kind of – now what are they going to do tomorrow? Well, I mean, they killed it. I'm not going to lie, but
– you know, you're right. I mean, a lot of people didn't like night one, but I think we're all in agreement here that night two was magical and was absolutely perfection.
Hey, the dessert was so good. I said, screw it. It was a good meal. We're coming back to this restaurant. Hell yeah, you got me on the strawberry shortcake, mama. Woo. Your burger sucked, but whatever.
We broke down
as a professional wizard. I think night two was just absolute magic.
Mm-hmm.
I feel justified that I can say that because, as my name says right here, the Wizard CZ.
I'm not going to question you.
Okay, Wiz, let me ask you, because we talked about, we broke down night one, and we kind of were in agreement. The first two matches were okay. The middle three matches were the last two matches were good. What was so magical about night two, Wiz, from start to finish?
I don't know if I can pinpoint one particular thing. I mean, here's the thing. We all knew, for the most part, where most of these matches were going to end up. I think most of the universe knew that Drew McIntyre was going to beat Seth Rollins, knew that Bayley was going to beat beat EO knew that Cody was going to finish the story. The other matches, obviously, so there was some entertainment. You know, particularly AJ Styles and LA Knight, I didn't know where that was going to go. I knew what I hoped for, and what I hoped for happened. But I just, top to bottom, I don't think there was a moment in this match that I can downplay, or in this card that I can downplay on the show. I gave night one a C+. I gotta give night two an A+. Absolutely 100%. Possibly, arguably the greatest WrestleMania night in history. Arguably. I will put it up against 17. I will put it up against 25. I think it was that good.
Shank, what's your letter grade for WrestleMania Night 2?
Oh, yeah, A plus. It hit. I enjoyed it. I really did. Hey, why am I the weird guy? I like that triple threat. Because, like, the whole time I'm like, so when do these two punch each other? And then, they were like, "Hey, check this route out." And then he does the RKO, and he's like, "Yeah, my bad. I didn't." Here's the thing: normally, you fall with me, but you didn't fall with me. Sorry. No, we're fighting. All right, we're fighting. See, I love that. See, I'm so bad because I get mad at people who, like, make wrestling crap and, like, mess around and do too much comedy. But then again, I'm also the same dude, like, hey, yo, dick and fart joke the whole match. I'm in. So it's, I don't know. That's why I love it. I love it when it was a little bit of just a twist. It was like, yeah, we're going to see each other, but first we're going to beat him up. And then they're like, you ready? I'm ready. Hockey fight. I love it.
I'm glad they got to that point because it was turning into the world's friendliest three-way dance there for a while.
Oh, it really was. I was like, this is – you don't see that very often, though. That's what was kind of nice.
Well, usually we go in order of the matches. Let's break this one down first. Let's break down this U.S. triple threat match between the champion Logan Paul, Randy Orton, KO. What'd you think of the entrances of the three guys for the match? You know, Mania's big time entrances. What'd you think of their entrances?
I popped. When Kevin Owens brought the card out, and then when he looks this, I was like, oh, he's got. I am Kevin Owens. I swear to God. I don't know. We're going to fight, but you know what? Hey, yo, this is a long walk, bro. Check this out. Come back. Get on. Hang on, buddy. We're going to go a couple laps. I would have went around the ring twice, but that's just Shanky Baby being with you.
Randy looked a little shaky on the back of that golf cart.
Slow down, Kevin.
He was really bracing himself for KO to throw on the brakes or for KO to
swerve. Imagine if we had like a Sin Cara on the back of that son of a gun. Logan Paul would have gotten taken out.
I really enjoyed this triple threat match. I'm not going to sit here and tell you I'm a Logan Paul fan because there's stuff that he does that annoys me.
Yeah.
There hasn't been a star that's adapted to the wrestling ring quite like we've seen Logan Paul adapt. And I think that needs to be commended. I think we need to give him a round of applause. He goes in there. You can tell he's taking it seriously. It's not a joke to him. And it shows in his work. And I think he needs to be applauded for that. You know, you hear Logan Paul Prime, you hear the streaming, you think he's annoying, whatever. The guy markets himself very well. He cares about the business and it shows in the ring. And I just think he doesn't get enough kudos for that.
No. I'm not a big fan of his brother, but even look at his brother. Like, that's, you can't tell me, like, I was a cage fighter for 11 years. Those aren't fake punches, bud. He's slinging leather at somebody. He's in there grinding. He's in there pushing in every day at the gym. Like, granted, I'm cheering for him every time, against him every time, but same, but like them Paul brothers, man, they just got that. They were high school wrestlers. I hate to say that, but I feel like that's just the mentality we get as a wrestler, a high school wrestler myself. You know, you learn to be tough, and that's kind of adapt and be tough.
No doubt the amateur wrestling background has helped him transition into the professional wrestling ring. CZ, what were your thoughts on this triple threat match? And what do you think is next for Logan Paul as he, you know, comes out of this still the champion?
Well, first thing I want to say, when Logan Paul came out in that prime truck, I thought for sure we were going to see a Stone Cold or Kurt Angle moment where he is just hosing people down with prime. I thought that's what was going to, and then he turned it towards the entrance and the fireworks went off and I'm like, okay, we're safe from anyone getting drenched in Logan's piss water. That's a good thing. As far as where he goes now, holding that U.S. title, I think it was the right move. I don't think KO or Randy need the title right now. I don't know, man. I so many people that he could go up against on SmackDown. I would love to see. I would love to honestly, if I were picking matches, I would love to see either an Andrade or a Santos Escobar. I know they're feuding right now, or that they were going into WrestleMania, but I would love to see one of them step into the U.S. title picture and go against Logan Paul, because I think they could put on a hell of a show.
I guess we'd be remiss if we didn't mention that the draft is coming up in 3 weeks. So we're going to get a bunch of fresh matchups, whether Logan Paul stays on SmackDown or not. If he stays on SmackDown, more people come in, be able to challenge him. Maybe they flip the titles and he goes to Raw, where there's a bunch of new fresh matchups. But yeah, I think the future is bright for him. I love the fact that he's had a sustained reign. He's taken it seriously. Who would you like to see Logan Paul take on next, Shank?
Actually, I'm real quick. This is like, because I was, you know, what I said to you guys earlier before I got on while I was late. What if one of those guys won the title off Logan Paul and then turned it into the Mexican title? Like took the U.S. off of it and made it like a Mexican territory belt. I'm just saying. I think that'd be awesome.
I don't mind it. It's something.
Dude,
I don't
mind like the flag with the eagle and the like the snake. Like, come on.
Wouldn't bother.
And then that's like the whole gimmick, bro. And then some like who can do that? Okay, and then we can get Shorty G. What's his name again?
Chad Gable.
Why can't Chad Gable lace up that American red, white, and blue singlet in the boots and go out there like Kurt Angle and defend our get our belt back? There's a gear right there, brother. I'm in.
Chad Gable, Logan Paul would interest me, just like Chad Gable.
Chad Gable needs his respect. Come on.
I think Chad Gable's going to get his respect. I think he's going to get his respect. We'll talk about Chad Gable getting his respect a little bit later when we break down the night after Raw, but I like that idea, Chad Gable, Logan Paul. That'd be an excellent matchup.
Watch him break in half.
You know, that's a. That makes me think. You know, we'll talk. Well, no, never mind. We're gonna hold off because Chad Gable, the interactions with Sami Zayn, that's on Raw. We're gonna wait. I'm trying to backtrack into night one. I don't want to do that. We're gonna move on. Honestly, I
by the way, that brought a tear into my eye.
I'm
a huge Sami fan.
That was brilliant. I want to talk a little bit about what everybody on paper that I've talked to thinks was a stinker match of the night. You guys know what I'm going to bring up here: the Pride versus the Final Testament. Let me start by telling you what I liked about this match. I liked the fact that Snoop was on commentary. That made my entire night, because there was one line. They were talking about his gin and juice line with Dre. He says, "I just was sipping on some before I came out." Michael Cole asks, "But that's the only one you've had all night, right?" "Nah, nah, 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 nah." That would be so big.
This, you're right. This was probably on paper the stinker match of the night, but it followed such an emotional opener, which we'll talk about after this match, that it was the perfect follow up to what happened in the opening contest and then the cash in. All six of these guys were able to shine on this street fight. You had Bubba Ray Dudley in Philadelphia as a special guest referee. That got a good pop. I'll agree. I thought this match would have been the stinker on the card, but it really turned out to be a fun match. The crowd seemed really into it. By the way, I think the crowd was bummed out on night one due to the fact of the crappy weather. It got really cold in that stadium and it was windy. Night two, the weather was much better and it seemed the attitude of the crowd was much more into it.
They probably dressed a little better too. They're like, maybe not so much.
Well, what did you think about this street fight, Shank, between the Pride and the Final Testament? Did you think it held up? Did you think it did what it needed to do?
Yeah, I mean, it's passable. That's how I look at it. I'm not gonna lie. Most of that time, I was looking down at my phone for that whole match.
You get honesty, and I love that honesty.
I mean, we get double honesty. You guys would have been looking down at my phone too if you would have been seeing what I was seeing. How you doing? Somebody was trying to get me to not come to watch WrestleMania anymore, and I was like, "Hey, honey, you better chill your ass out. I got wrestling to watch." I did think about it, to be honest with y'all. I did. I was like, "Cody, whatever. I could, whatever."
Cody, whatever.
You could do it for me. Cody, I got a story to go write myself. Be right back.
I got a story to go finish.
But mine ain't going to take me a year, brother. It's going to take me about 4 minutes.
<I'm> done. Let's go back to the opening contest of the night. We got the fight for the World Heavyweight Championship. We've got the challenger, Drew McIntyre, who has been red hot as of late leading up to this match. He's been gold on the mic. He's really made everyone hate him with his pettiness going after CM Punk, as long as, getting ready to take on Seth. And then you have Seth Rollins, the defending champ, defending World Heavyweight champ, the workmanlike effort he's put into putting a name on this title. He's done a great job of representing the brand with the title. And right off the bat, we almost get a 1-2-3 with a Claymore pop right off the bat. I thought for a second, man, they're going to go Daniel Bryan, Sheamus, and this is going to be a squash. But Seth was able to kick out. CZ, give me your opening thoughts in this match and what you really thought for the opener of night two. Because night two had to raise the bar. I mean, night two had a bar, raise the bar, in my opinion, and it really started off with these guys.
Oh, absolutely it did. Obviously, night one was such a low, high expectations, low delivery. Night two had to get that bar so much higher, and this was the great way to open it. I think going into the match, we all knew Becky's taking some time off, Seth's taking some time off. He's got to heal up a little bit. She's got her book tour, and they have their daughter that I'm sure they want to spend some family time with. So you kind of had a feeling that Seth was going to drop the belt here. I loved the cash-in. I loved the fact that Drew was kneeling on the announce table, just berating CM Punk, and Punk is just sitting there, "I got cans on. I can't hear you, buddy. I don't know what you're saying." That was hilarious. That was fantastic. And then the fact that Punk cost him the title and Priest came in 9 seconds. The match with Damian Priest lasted 9 seconds. So you want to talk about a Daniel Bryan Sheamus squash match? Boom, right there. Of course, Drew had already been through a 10-minute match, but yeah, I thought this delivered. This was all that I had expected it to be and more.
Shank, what'd you think of the opener for night two? Did it?
Okay, so first off, me and that Damian Priest match have a lot in common. 9 seconds is about the farthest we got. So back to what I was saying, though. So what I really love, and I noticed we do. What's up? Oh, my dude, Damian Priest, love that guy. I noticed we do this at APW. I call it the bridge system, where you start, because imagine that match at co-main event. Like, that's a lot of emotion for a lot of people to handle in a short amount of time. So, like, what we do, you start one match with something big, something hot, preferably a title match. That's a one of your points, and then you just swing it down up to your main. Boom, main event's the other post, and it usually kicks off pretty well.
Well, I think.
Yeah, I know. I believe me. I'm a huge Drew fan.
Everybody in this room is genuinely love the cash in, I think. Emily here says that she hated the cash in. Drew deserved a decent reign. We'll talk about that in a second, but go ahead, Shank. Talk about what you thought about the match and the cash in.
I mean, dude, okay. Real quick about the match. Match was everything we all expected it. You expected a good one. You got a great one. That's it. You know what I mean? It delivered. When you put two people like that together, it delivers. It doesn't matter. Cash in. Can I say something? Drew kind of like, yeah, I won the belt. I'm like, I feel like he's about to get his ass kicked. He's going to get cashed in on. And he just... When somebody wins, they're like, give me the strap, brother. Like, let me hang. He was just sitting there like, mm-mm. And I was like, what are you doing, dude? Celebrate a little bit. So, like, I just felt off.
He was so consumed with rubbing it in Punk's face that he didn't really truly enjoy the moment. And then the moment got snatched from him. I love Drew going over there and getting in Punk's face. Hey, somebody take this picture. I want it framed on my wall. I love that part. I love Punk sitting there taking it. And then finally Punk had enough. Down goes Drew. As he takes his jacket off, I'm like, oh my God, he's going to can him with that elbow brace. This is great. The cash in's coming. And then this production team of Punk hits him with the brace. Damian Priest music hits. And then you see Punk look at the camera and just kind of smile like this. And then out comes Priest. I thought that was brilliant.
Dude, it really was.
Can I take a moment? I don't remember if we've talked about this on air or not. I know we've talked about it off air. But since Kevin Dunn has left, we did talk about it with Joe. The production has been just so far beyond better than what it was. Everything has a more real sports feel, and it gets you invested that much more.
The dude's teeth aren't probably as big either.
Have you noticed the production and how it is? It gives it more of a big fight feel. It makes it feel more real.
I wonder why. Because the people who bought them, UFC has got, I'm gonna say, fucking sweet. I mean, I've been a UFC fan for a very long time because that's how I got, you know, 05 I started watching it. I played video games like in 2002, like, because sidetracked. Where were we at?
Production.
It's way better. Yeah. It's like just the camera angles of like, I don't know. It's just not your typical wrestling had a formula and it was just, that's all we knew. That's all we've seen. Now the UFC has a whole setup and now the same company, they're like, why can't we do this? I've noticed UFC. You notice UFC does entrances now a little extra. I wonder where they're getting that from. Their neighbor over here. You know, they're stealing from each other. That's all they're doing.
They're stealing from each other, and it's benefiting both. I mean,
here's the thing. Nobody watched Bellator. Bellator MMA did that crap so professional wrestling. They literally had the whole Titantron, and I'm talking the big one, all LED board, and then they would have some, like, your flag, your highlights, and then you as like a giant, and then the screen would come up, and then it would be you standing there with smile. I'm like, dog, sign me. And I had like four of my friends fought for Bellator, so that was cool.
So you don't think there's a problem with them borrowing from each other? I mean, I think
if it's doing good, right?
Yeah, yeah, both.
Why not steal? They're not competing with each other. They're two different sports. They don't give a rat's butt. You know what would be cool? If the NFL stole from the NBA, which is the camp, sometimes on Disney Plus, it's kind of funny. You can literally get the scoreboard. They have the camera at the very top of the scoreboard. You can watch the game from that scoreboard. why the heck aren't we watching stuff from like the pylon? Like, why aren't you watching stuff from like the goalpost? Why aren't we getting that? That goalpost cam in the red zone would be pretty freaking cool. You literally could see the entire formation. If they run the ball in, how the, you know, if the guards are pulling, it's like, yeah, I would love that. Then again, I'm also a football guru, so I'm kind of one of those dudes. Like, I hate watching football with my friends sometimes. I'll watch positions. I won't even watch the game.
CZ, any more thoughts on the opening match before we continue with our breakdown of night two?
Not really. I think we've said it all. I don't think there's anything else that can be said. That was just a fantastic way to open the show. You would say, Nick, chef's kiss.
Chef's kiss. It was chef's kiss. We'll talk more about chef's kiss here in a little bit. Let's talk about one more match before we take a break, and that is going to be the singles contest between AJ Styles and LA Knight. They did a really good build up into Mania with this with these two guys. There was a backstory there, which was great. They had an altercation at WWE World on Friday. AJ Styles got bloodied up a little bit. I really like the angle. I really like the backstory. What are your guys' thoughts on this match between Styles and LA Knight?
Let me talk to you, Nick. I thought, like you said, I love the build to this match. It's one thing we always talk about, you know, comparing. Let's compare wrestling companies a little bit. You watch an AEW, they don't have good builds for their matches most of the time. That is something that WWE has always done really well, is they make their matches mean something. And I've been invested in LA Knight since he came into NXT. His feud with Cameron Grimes over the $1 million title was just amazing. And then he gets called up to the main roster. He's put in situations with all the bit with the big dogs, Roman Reigns, now AJ Styles. Like Tim here, our boy Regal says, two good workers just having a really good match.
Yep.
I don't know if I can say anything more than that. That sums it up perfectly.
Shank, what do you think, bud?
Oh, it made my TNA heart happy. Yeah. Jesus Christ. Yeah. Let's go, baby. By the way, in my life, I literally, I'm a mailman now, by the way, in my shoot life. But every time I deal with somebody that's just a fucking dummy, I literally go, dummy, yeah. And I yell it out the window. And it is like, I need to get the dummy button so bad, dude.
Nick, yeah, what did you think about this?
God, I loved it, dude.
I'm sorry, Shank.
No, you're fine. I'm sorry. I shouldn't be cutting off people here. My bad. Throat chop. Sorry. You got to do it right if you're going to cut somebody off. So, like I said, I'm a huge TNA mark. So to like see, first off, holy jack, AJ, dude. First off, DM me all the subscriptions, all the stuff. Give me all of it. I don't care. I'll stick it in my butt. I don't give a crap. Jesus Christ. But LA Knight and him, dude, he's had two great workers. Like, what are you going to do? It goes right back. Seth and fucking, goddamn, I'm having a bad day today.
No, you're all
fucking
right.
Seth and Claymore City out there, Drew, they were having you just put two good workers together and it's going to shine. It doesn't matter. You do that at any level, whether you do it in the indies, whether you do it in the, you know, the paid pros, you put two good workers together, you're going to get some magic.
Really happy for LA Knight to finally get a match on a Mania, to get a win on a Mania. But, I mean, when was the last time AJ Styles had a bad match? It just doesn't happen. He's a tremendous worker. And putting him with LA Knight and with the backstory they had, these guys went out there and put on a good show.
When AJ's done, you could argue GOAT. I don't give a shit.
It's good. It's a good thought, man.
You may not call it promo GOAT. You can cut away the character and stuff, but like in ring, who has done it? Jericho, they used to call that type, and he's fallen off. AJ's not. AJ won't. He's Tom Brady, baby. All day, every day. Get that boy some more rings.
I agree. I would like to see him get another run or two before it's all said and done. I really would. You're right. He is phenomenal. No pun intended there.
Oh, that's why. That's personally, out of everybody on the roster, I would push for my personal ego. I love LA Knight. I don't get like to me. Cody could have lost, and I'm gonna be like, cool. Next, you ready? Hit your music. Let's go, kid. Like, I love LA Knight. He makes me just pay attention.
And now he's going to make the rest of the wrestling world pay attention, picking up a win over AJ Styles at WrestleMania Night 2. We are the Card Subject to Change podcast. We are powered by Lopez Pizza, built by Durham Remodeling, colored by Ryan Allison Tattoo, and protected by Jared Zook of Country Financial. Welcome aboard. Thank you for sponsoring the show. We are going to take a quick break here. We are with Brandon the Shank Eubanks. We are breaking down Night 2 of WrestleMania. We've also got to break down the Monday Night Raw after Mania as well. We've got to pay some dues. Stick with us. We'll see you back here on the other side.
Football season may be over, but for frequency's sake, still has you covered for all your sporting needs. Tune in every Sunday when the best professional wrestling podcast around, Card Subject to Change, gets you caught up on everything inside the ropes. They won't miss a count with weekly analysis and interviews. More into auto racing? We've got a double dose for you on the track. Tune in to Fast Money with Rod Villagomez each week and win some money with the quickest bets in all of sports. Want more insight from Pit Row? Check out the Green, White, and Checkered podcast where they give their insight on everything happening on and off the track. Need your basketball fix? Points in the Paint has you covered with live shows every other week looking at everything in the association. Backed by popular demand, we have the return of The Payoff Pitch, FFSQC's baseball show, covering you on news around the MLB. If you're missing football, don't fret. Mark and Dan still have you covered in the football lounge. Missing Joe Winkle? Probably not, but he's still here talking sports on Educated Ignorance. Football season might be over, but we've still got you covered. For frequency's sake, you know what we mean.
For frequency's sake is brought to you by Durham Remodeling, serving the Quad City area's remodeling and repair needs since 1973. Clint's Draft House, grab a bite and a pint. 7th Street Moline. Lopies, New York-style pizza served up by the slice or pie, Davenport. Lifted Energy, energy drinks, coffee, donuts, and more, hashtag get lifted. Atomic Sports Cards and Collectibles, sports cards and memorabilia, vintage clothing, hats, pennants, and more. Ryan Allison Tattoo, step into the vibrant world of tattoos with Ryan Allison. And A Cut Above, offering quality custom woodwork designed specifically around our customers.
Welcome back to the show. We are the Card Subject to Change podcast, powered by Lopez Pizza, built by Durham Remodeling, colored by Ryan Allison Tattoo, and protected by Jared Zook Financial, Country Financial. We have a little bit more business to take care of here before we get back into the meat and potatoes of this episode. Want to talk to you about the Sandra Lee Memorial Car Show. That is coming up on May 4th at the Rock Island County Fairgrounds, and I am proud to officially announce that the Card Subject to Change is one of the great sponsors of this event. All the proceeds for this show, 100%, this is a charity event, go to the Autism Society of the Quad Cities. This is their third year running, and it's the first year that they are bringing a wide variety of celebrities, particularly wrestling celebrities. Let me throw some names out at you guys. Godfather, Coco Beware, Cowboy Bob Orton. I lost my train of thought there. Fred Ottman, who is known better as Tugboat, or, if you will, the Shockmaster. We also have USWA superstar Luke Graham Jr. and the original Glow Girl, Hollywood, making appearances. Plus Von Hot Rod in the car area. So come on out to the Rock Island County Fairgrounds on May the 4th to meet, greet, and get some autographs and pics. They are providing posters for autographs. They are limited supply, but you can get yours, get the autograph. You'll see our logo on that poster. $5 donations are what's suggested. If you want to register a vehicle, it's $20. And you can also enter to win a raffle for a Pepsi pedal car for just $1. It's going to be a lot of fun. Card Subject to Change will have a presence there. We are going to get to talk to some of those famous wrestlers that I mentioned. It's going to be a blast, Nick. I'm excited for it.
I got one question for you, Wiz. Are you going to jump on the ho train?
Well, you know, pimping ain't easy.
Can you take a guess which one of those guys I've wrestled?
Which guy did you wrestle?
Take a guess.
Was it the Godfather?
Nope.
No? Okay. Nick, Cowboy I'm going to let you take a shot.
Yeah. That no good, broken arm shitbag, Cowboy Bob Orton. He beat my ass.
All right.
What the hell I was doing in there with that boy? Awesome. I have no idea, dude. I'm going to tell you guys, just because he's old don't mean nothing. Jesus Christ.
That's very true, and I imagine he is a badass. Gentlemen, yeah. One more piece of business. We got to welcome our collaborator, Mr. JT Energy, and we need to take just a quick moment to focus. We'll be right back.
Well, well, well. It's time for a moment of focus with the feline phenom, JT Energy. Can you feel it? Can you smell it? It's there. It's palpable in the air. You know what we need to focus on this week? Being present. Present in the moment. Because every single day has the opportunity, has a moment that you need to cherish. You need to feel it. You need to let it sink in. Just because it's a Monday or a Tuesday or a Wednesday or a Thursday does not mean it's not as good as a Friday, a Saturday, or a Sunday. Don't let what you know up here dictate how every single day means something more than the other day. So it's your job to think up here and to focus on making every single day, every single moment mean something. Because you deserve it and everybody else deserves it. This has been a moment of focus with the feline phenom, JT Energy.
Hey man, did y'all see that garage? That was a nice garage.
I thought so too.
I was like, bro, dude. Whoa, man. Man, I could put a nice car in there. Put my motorcycle in there. Holy crap, man. JT. And I was listening and he had me focused.
He said something in that moment of focus that perked me up and said deserving. And that segues right into our next match. And that was the women's, the WWE women's championship match, Bayley and Io Sky. And I just want to say how happy I am for Bayley to finally win one on a big stage and to get her belt back and get a little measure of revenge over damage control and how deserving that was of her. What'd you guys think of that match?
It was a lot of fun. I'm glad, like you said, that Bayley was able to get her moment. With a big win, with a championship win on the biggest stage of them all. I have loved Bayley. I'm not fully sold on the whole Egyptian thing. I know Corey Graves explained something about an Egyptian-themed playground where she grew up. I'm a little confused about that. But overall, I thought it was a great match.
Yeah. No, I mean, having every single one of your people turn on you and then you finally, you know, stick it back to them and you're the champ. I love it. Another one done.
Yeah, this match, I mean, it wasn't the greatest women's match by any means, but it did tell a good story. It got the point across. Bayley was able to extract revenge and get the belt from Io Sky and get a little one-upsmanship on damage control. I'm glossing over that match because I think we really need to devote some time to Chef's Kiss, the main event. I think expectations were high coming into this match for everybody. Everybody, you know, finishing the story, would Reigns' reign continue? I just want to flat out come out and say both of these guys put on an absolute clinic in keeping the crowd enthralled and having a wrestling match before the whole shit show began, the glorious shit show that it was.
Yes.
What a match. Roman might have worked his best match of his whole reign in this match right here. I was enthralled and really impressed with how Roman worked in this match.
Oh, agreed. But before we get into the actual match itself, I want to talk about Cody's entrance. The rise up with the American Nightmare skull mask gave me absolute chills. I thought it was brilliant. It felt to me like an homage to Triple H, as well as, you know, Cody just being who he is. And then Brandy coming out and taking the mask off of him and getting him ready to walk down that aisle. It was just absolutely perfect.
Those WrestleMania entrances are like, it's like the NFL, it's like the Super Bowl commercials. You just expect it at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
For sure, for sure. Nick, any thoughts on your end on Cody's entrance into the ring?
Well, I mean, you know, Triple H doesn't get those extravagant entrances anymore. So Cody's going to take his spot. And yeah, I thought it was a little homage, a tip of the cap to Triple H with the skull, but also the American Nightmare skull. You know, it's definitely Cody's symbol, but I thought it was a little homage to Triple H. It's the first thing I thought of when I seen him come out was, oh, this kind of feels very Triple H-esque. But I mean, it doesn't take away from it. It was awesome. You're going to have your extravagant, kick-ass, awesome WrestleMania entrances, and this was it.
Absolutely. And the fact that these two went out and put on just such a brilliant match before the shenanigans, just toe-to-toe, everything was pieced together well. I love it. I agree with you, Nick. This could have been Roman's best match of this run overall, because he just did such a hell of a job, him and Cody both, making everything look and feel just fantastic.
The knock on Roman was, oh, every match is the same. Some member of the bloodline is going to interfere, and then he's going to win. What he made you remember here is how good of a wrestler he is, and he got all that wrestling in, and he got that across before the shenanigans began. And when the shenanigans began, it was just okay, full blown. Here we go. This ride isn't stopping until we get done, and there's no turning back now. And I love when the shit started. It took a while for the shit to finish.
Yo. How about that tackle off or the spear off the stage? I was sitting there and I was thinking to myself, I'm like, man, if that was me and my brother, I would fucking tackle that mother. Boom! I was like, oh, he did it! He killed him!
that tackle off the entrance ramp made me forget about their shitty match the night before.
Y'all, that match sucked.
Oh, God. We're in agreement there, man. That match was 11 minutes of my life. I'm never getting back. It was awful.
Just real. Horrendous.
It was bad.
But that dive off stage saved it and started the catalyst of the shitstorm. Wiz, any thoughts leading up to the shitstorm and what you... Did it meet your expectations, or was there something more you wanted to see?
Yes and no. I mean, I would have loved to see Stone Cold make his way in. I think
Thank
he would
you.
Have been better than The Undertaker. The Undertaker and The Rock don't have that big of a history together from my recollection. But The Rock and Stone Cold, that is some deep-seated history. 15, 17, 19, not to mention everything in between those three WrestleManias. I don't know if he had some conflict that he couldn't get in, and I'm not upset by The Undertaker being there by any means. It just didn't fit the story, in my opinion. It didn't fit where we were in the history of the wrestlers that were involved, the people that were involved in this overbooked, for lack of a better term, match.
Yeah, I somebody told me that it made sense because Roman beat Taker and Taker was in that, and it wasn't for The Rock. It's not The Rock's match. I'm like, yeah, okay, cool. So we're all mad that the glass didn't break, right? And they're all like, yeah. I'm like, see, kind of stupid.
I just want to say that I'm really disappointed the glass didn't break, because I was really looking forward. I was watching, I wasn't with Nick, but I was really looking forward to getting a picture from Joe with his happy man tears when the glass broke.
When the glass broke, I was going to cry happy man tears. I was waiting for that moment, and I didn't get that moment, but it still was perfection to me. I wanted Austin to be there, but man, they still hit a home run with it. They really did.
No, they really
and
did.
I popped when the Undertaker's bell went boom. I'm like, yes, you know, like, it was awesome.
Yeah. I don't mean to backtrack real quick, but talking about man tears and Stone Cold Steve Austin, I sat in a room silently and cried the most straight face, just pouring tears, but wasn't making a single face movement while watching him versus Kevin Owens. And if I ever get to meet Kevin Owens, I'm going to probably cry, and I want to thank him for everything, because that locked up my childhood right there. I was over it. I was like, that's it. It's good enough for me, boys. But yeah, that.
You know what? And I got to thinking about that. That was perfection between Austin and Owens. And maybe Stone Cold didn't want to come back and tarnish that. Maybe he didn't want to be a part of this. I don't know. Maybe they didn't reach out to him. Who knows? I think everybody wanted to hear the glass break one more time. Everybody wanted to see The Rock take a stunner like no one else can. I mean, The Rock.
Listen, they both. We could get a Rocky versus Stone Cold one more time. I'm just whooping that bald-headed candy ass. I'm here for it.
For as good as The Rock looked on night one of Mania, for the way he was going through tables, he didn't look like he missed a beat. And I'm telling you what, he looked like he was on the road with these guys for the last 6 months, night in and night out. Like, he looked flawless in night one, and he knew his role on night two. He came out there and did what he had to do. Props to The Rock. He looked like a million bucks on nights.
Oh, I completely agree. He did a fantastic job. He knew what he was there for. And seeing him in the ring again, I thought for sure that Roman was going to do a majority of the work in that tag match on night one. But The Rock came out and he shined. He showed up. Showed up and showed out, as they say.
What were your guys' genuine reactions when Cody did finish the story? When he finally, I mean, hold on, before we get there, we got to talk about Seth coming out and the callback to the Shield.
Hey, did anybody else go, holy shit, he switched teams? And then it didn't happen.
Yeah.
I was going, holy shit, when I heard Sierra, Hotel, Indigo, Echo, Lima, Delta, Shield. Like, that one, like, yes! Yes!
And then we got one.
And we only got and one. Then,
I wasn't sure who was coming out. I don't know what Moxley's contract status is, but I'm like, are we getting Dean fucking Ambrose back? That was my first thought.
That's exactly where I was just like, freak. And then it just waited. And then it got to the point where Seth gets hit. And I'm like, was that a dummy, Seth? Was that a fake one? Did we get Sting? Did Sting fall from the ceiling again? Like, where are we at here?
I think
the long-term storytelling they had with Seth coming in and Seth being the final distraction for Roman. Roman took his eyes off the prize and let the greed get in the way. He had a prone Cody Rhodes where he could go for the win. But him coming out in the Shield gear was the plan, according to Regal. I love it. I love that Roman couldn't see past Seth and had to go after Seth one more time, and it ended up cost him everything.
Yeah.
Hey, see two dudes without titles and a long line of history. I don't know. Listen, I've only been doing this wrestling thing for a short time, so I really don't know much about it, but I see two pieces of bread and some meat. It looks like a sandwich to me, Daddy.
Depending on what, how much Roman take time Roman takes off, is that the first feud you want to see Roman in when he comes back? Is Roman Seth? Granted, they're both healthy and they're both back.
Let one of them come back first, do something for a short second, and then the second one comes back after them for them.
So yes. Let me ask you, gentlemen, how much time do we see both Roman and Seth taking off? How long before we see them come back on TV?
I'd say 6 to 8. Roman probably deserves a big break too. Yeah. I only say that because I can't. You get itchy after a while. Even if you've been doing it for a while, you still get itchy.
Yeah, that's very true.
Seth, I don't know if he's got to have surgery or if he just needs time to heal. I would imagine we see Seth back before Roman. I think Roman will take an extended amount of time off. That's just my opinion. But
if Roman comes back and doesn't have the Big Dog theme song, I'm not watching it anymore.
You don't like the current theme song?
No, I do. I just love throwing this. I just like throwing shit back to stupid stuff. Like nobody liked it. It was dumb. Big Dog. I think it's the stupidest thing, but I would love it. I would love it.
I would laugh. I would laugh.
I'd laugh my ass off.
I would laugh and then I'd be sad because I love this. But I, in a world, in my booking mind, I see Seth back first. Maybe Seth has some success. And then out of nowhere is when the Big Dog comes back.
Damn it.
I would pop for that one time and one time only because I absolutely despise that Michael Cole. I'm pretty sure he was forced to say this every time, but like with Sasha Banks, it's ball time or it's the Big Dog. I would pop for that one time as a throwback and then that's it. Never again.
I would never be allowed back if it happened twice because I talked it into existence.
I don't want this to get lost in the talk of this main event, but the commentary team was amazing.
Yes.
All three guys were great during this match, and I thought the moments that needed carried by the commentary team, they did a great job. I like this three-man booth of Cole. I'm happy for Cole. I'm so happy for Cole. He doesn't have Vince screaming in his ear and Kevin Dunn screaming in his ear. He gets to be himself. He gets to be a wrestling fan first and foremost, calling the action. I love McAfee. You can tell, like much like Logan Paul cares about the wrestling and being in the ring, McAfee cares about the product. He's having the time of his life, and he cares about it. And Graves plays his character up to a T. I love this three-man booth.
Yeah.
I do, too. I love it. They do a fantastic job, and they all play well off of each other, in my opinion. I think Graves is honestly the next in line. When Michael Cole retires, we're going to see Corey Graves step into that role. And I see Corey Graves being able to really do well with anyone that he's put with. He does a great job with Barrett on SmackDown. He does an amazing job in the three-man booth on the pay-per-views. I love everything about Corey Graves, and he is next in line to he is the heir apparent, we'll all say, to Michael Cole's prime commentary, in my opinion.
We kind of got lucky, if you ask me, generation to generation. Kind of like the Brett Favre to Aaron Rodgers. We kind of, you know, we got JR and King, and then moved that into Michael Cole. Like, don't get me wrong. Like, we've had a lot of good ones. But, like, I actually like JBL on the desk not too long. I actually enjoyed him. But Michael Cole has been the staple. He's been the one.
Cole's been there since WrestleMania. WrestleMania 15 was his first one. He's got 25 WrestleManias.
I acknowledge that. Let's go.
What's that?
I said I acknowledge that. Let's go.
Yeah, I do too. I think he's doing a great job. I went back and watched this match again. And when I go back and watch matches, I pick one thing out. And the second time I went back and watched, I really dwelt I focused on the commentary, and it just, I can't say enough good things, and I hope it doesn't get lost in the annals of time just how good the commentary was for this match. I asked the question a couple minutes ago, and I got ahead of myself, but what were your guys' genuine feelings? 1, 2, 3, Cody finishes the story.
Loved it.
Yes.
You want my actual faith? Like, yeah, it's good.
Finally and got it. When he goes, when the celebration is in the ring and he hands the belt to his mom, how does that not stir emotion in anyone?
Because we're dead and we don't have mothers.
I wasn't crying. You were crying.
I loved this. Had a WrestleMania 10 feel with the face locker room emptying out and coming in and celebrating with them. Cool to see all those guys in one ring for the celebration of Cody, the coronation of Cody. Really cool to see a guy like Randy Orton out there who worked with Cody when Cody was younger and part of the legacy. And seeing Sami Zayn and KO, Punk coming out, Cena coming out. I mean, everybody was out. Cool moment when he called out Bruce Pritchard and Triple H. I thought that was really icing on the cake. It was perfection. This Mania, when you think of post celebrations now, you won't think of 20 anymore. You'll think of 40. And how wonderfully perfect the match was. The shit show was beautiful. It was a beautiful shit storm. Roman going out on his shield. No pun intended there. But he had his finest match in his last match as champion. And I just can't say enough good things. This Mania Night 2 made me forget about the crap that happened on night one that I didn't agree with or didn't like, and went home happy, right? That's what you're supposed to do, is go home happy as a wrestling fan, right?
Yeah.
Well, absolutely. Depends on what show you go to.
That's right. That's fair. You're right. But on WrestleMania Night 2, you want people to go home happy, right?
We went home happy.
Now we delve into the Monday night Raw after the Raw after Monday night or WrestleMania, always known as Raw after Mania, biggest Raw of the year. When you're talking about the fallout from Mania, new storyline starting, some call-ups. The show starts off with Cody and Triple H doing their little glad handing in the ring. Cody gives his acceptance speech pretty much, and then the final boss, The Rock, has some words for Cody. What did you guys think of the exchange on Monday Night Raw between Cody and the final boss, and when are they going to be in the ring together?
Shank, I'll let you take this one first, man.
Dude, hell no. I wouldn't hand my title over to ain't nobody. I'll whoop your ass, you touch my belt. By the way, did we all notice when he handed it over and then he shouldered it? I'm like, Cody, shoulder his belt. Come on, dude. What are you just?
Cody held it there like it was a newspaper that got pissed all over. He like he didn't want to hold. Like I would have thrown that people's championship belt over my shoulder. And
my favorite part was Philadelphia being as Philadelphia as it possibly can. And Chan, this is awkward. awkward. I love Philly for a fucking reason, man. They're savages.
Can I just call out that this was a throwback to when The Rock unveiled the the WWE, the W logo belt several years ago, and Cody came into the ring asking to take a look at that belt. Did anybody else catch that?
I don't remember. I didn't catch that. I'm glad you did. That's why you're here, man. You caught it. I didn't catch that. Would that have been after WrestleMania? When would that have been? What time was that?
You're putting me on the spot. I don't remember specifically.
Regardless, you caught it. You caught it, and I didn't. So props to you, man.
It would have been. So it was a very similar belt that The Rock unveiled, just slight tweaks to make it more Rock-esque. So it would have been when did he win the title off of Cena in their 2013? Once, twice in a lifetime? Yeah.
The Rock won at 28 and Cena won it back at 29.
Would have been right around that time frame.
Okay. Okay. But that segment left me wanting more. I think this is your main event at SummerSlam. When The Rock gets done shooting his movie or has time away from his movie, you'd like to think he'd be able to get away for SummerSlam, which is beginning of August. So a little over 4 months away. I don't know how long this movie's going to take to shoot, wrap, all that stuff. But I mean,
can you say something?
The Rock pinned Cody on Saturday night. He's got a legitimate gripe to the title.
Yes.
Real quick, man, The Rock's movies suck lately. He should have stick to wrestling.
I agree. Yeah, I agree.
Like, hey, I'm gonna be honest with you. You probably do make more money.
Pre-WrestleMania press conferences, like the outdoors, one of them. Black Adam sucked.
Hey, you can't have instant classics all the time like the Tooth Fairy. I'm just
hang on. Hang on. You know what it is? I think Cena stole his thunder because Cena's just perfect. Uh-oh. Do you think the movie torch has been handed off?
Yeah, maybe possibly. It has. I mean, Cena's
do you think these two now need to have a cinematic match right now?
Ooh, I like that idea.
Yeah, let's delve into that. I mean, you can argue that they set it up for something like that with the way the shenanigans happened at the end of night two.
They've wrestled each other twice now. Mania 28, Mania 29, they split. Maybe there's a theatric match at WrestleMania 41 and Cena's retirement match. I like that idea, man.
Cena was on Pat McAfee. He said he's got about 3.5 years left. And he's really hungry and wants to get wrestling.
Cena said that. Wow. So maybe him and Rock do it one more time.
Roll it back.
Hang on. Maybe we have a triple threat. First time ever. These two are staring at each other. Me and him get our wish. The glass breaks. We all cry happy fucking tears.
Oh.
And he just walks out there, hands out a couple wizened ass whoopings. Stomps a mud hole in the invisible guy and fucking hands off a couple stunners. 1, 2, 3. We all celebrate like it's 1998 again. Let's have a good day.
Let's do it.
Hey, real quick. So, like, I want a fantasy book like for 2 minutes. So, like,
sure.
Okay.
Sure.
So, imagine if we backtracked and Damian Priest lost his briefcase to R-Truth. And then R-Truth cashed in at the end on Cody and beat Cody for the title. Who's mad? Who's mad? I'll tell you who's not. This guy. Because that guy has wrestled for so long and forever. Never been the WWE guy. We would all love it. Now, hear me out. He thinks it's the Intercontinental title the entire time. I'm your Intercontinental champion. Like, true. No. It's the Miz that has to follow him around the whole time. Like, dog, no.
It's not the WWE title.
Oh, my bad.
Oh, my bad.
What did you guys
think? Who wants this?
What did you guys think?
He don't think that Gunther's the champ.
What did you think of him last night sneaking up behind the Judgment Day and holding
up the tag? Listen, yes. What do you think? I want him to be the world champ, all right? I think that was the – I brought it back. I brought it back to the Judgment Day. And they're like, you're not in the Judgment Day. Dude, that shit is a direct line into my funny bone, and I don't understand why R-Truth is TNA, baby! Ron the Truth Killings, baby! Let's go! That's why.
Former NWA World Heavyweight Champion.
Former champ, baby!
Yes.
He has been nothing but gold in this run. I mean, we go back to
that. That's what I'm saying. Why aren't we making him our world champion right now? Here's the thing. What if he became the champ or like had a line to it? He gets hit in the head, and all of a sudden, he turns back into Ron the Truth Killings. No jokes, no laughter. We're serious. I'm a whoop your ass type dude. And then he loses, takes a bump in the head. My bad. What happened? He's right back.
Sorry, guys. That's on me. My bad.
Oh, my bad. He just realized what he did. He's like, oh, man, what the?
I love how Cena is his boyhood hero. Yes. Even though, you know.
He's older than John Cena?
6 years older than John Cena.
I'm going to start saying Hornswoggle is the greatest giant of all time.
outside of The Rock and Cody on their opening segment, R-Truth segment with the Judgment Day and match was funny. We get to see Cena on Monday Night Raw again. I thought Raw after Mania, I'm not going to sit here and be boo-hooing. I thought it was a little lackluster.
Yeah.
It's hard to take the call-ups legit when you're still the NXT champions. I'm talking about Ilya Dragunov, who is the men's NXT champion, and then Roxanne Perez. They both had singles matches last night on the Raw after Mania. They're both still the champions, so it's kind of hard to take those call-ups, you know, seriously when they're still champs.
Yeah. Yes,
I completely agree. I completely agree, but it was I'm sure you will fully admit this, Nick. It was nice seeing Ilya Dragunov on Monday Night Raw.
Yes, champ or no champ. I'm glad he's finally getting a call-up, if they're going to call this a call-up. I'm sure he's going to get drafted. I can see him dropping the belt between now and the draft taking place, so he doesn't have the NXT belt anymore. But it's good to see him on one of the brands. I don't care which brand he goes to, but the guy needs to be on one of the brands.
Yes,
who's his first opponent? It's Chad Gable. We already know. Let's go, baby.
Oh, let's do it. Let's do it. And what do you think about, hey, what is Gable going to do to Sami Zayn next week? That match has been set. Montreal, hometown. Do we see Gable turn?
And I was just thinking that.
Sami Zayn and get the title back? Or get the
title? A little
bit
of a heel turn. I can see it coming.
I don't like seeing my friends fight.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I know what you mean.
It hurts. It's dudes I really love. Like, the one guy I'm so happy for and the other guy I'm pulling for. So that's the problem. Well, I guess he's already had his dessert.
I think Gable gets it done. I think Gable
gets it done. Yeah, let's go, Gable. Let's go. We're Team Gable on this one.
I think we're Team Gable on this one. Sammy's made a Teflon. If he loses, it's not going to hurt him. But I think Gable is going to win this, and I think he's going to use shenanigans to win it, too. That's going to upset Sammy, but thank you. I can't wait for it to happen.
Thank you.
As he's walking out with the belt. Thank you. Canada's just booing him down.
Oh, Canada will boo his ass too.
He starts a USA chant. Yes. He starts his own USA chant. I'm in.
Anything else catch your guys' eye last night on the Raw after Mania? I know we brushed over real quick, but we all kind of agreed it was a bit of a letdown after what happened Sunday night and the chef's kiss perfection that it was.
I will say I did enjoy guilty pleasure when Chelsea Green went back with all of the general managers and they're like, oh yeah, we got you a match. Go head on out to the ring. And the look on her face when Jade Cargill came out was absolutely priceless. Chelsea has some of the greatest expressions in my opinion, in the WWE right now. I love watching reactions. That's one of the things, that's one of my favorite things, is watching how someone reacts to a loss, to a surprise, to just anything. I think if you have a good reaction to something, you're golden. And I'm not saying that Chelsea needs to be in like the women's world title picture by any means. She's not, I don't think she's there. I think she's more comedic relief, which is great. You've got to have that. But I love her reaction to Jade Cargill. I love the reaction when she lost the match. It was just well put together, in my opinion.
I'm impressed with Jade Cargill. Like, that shows you the type of training difference it takes. And you can, she's pulling it together. She's like vicious. I'm like, damn, girl.
She is chiseled from rock.
I kind of also have a crush on her. Oh. Problem. We call them beefy mommies. Like, kind of into buff girls. Kind of. That's what I hate about girls when they're like, I don't want to live because, like, I don't want to get, like, jacked. I'm like, I literally just heard I want to stay ugly. That's it. That's all I heard because I'm into buff chicks, dude. God, that Raquel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Yeah. I want to ask, we learned
a new term tonight, CZ. Beefy mamas.
Beefy mamas.
I like it.
I think we need to start a shirt line, you know, with some of the catchphrases that come off on this show. That is the first shirt right there. Beefy mamas.
Yes.
Beefy mamas wanted.
Wanted beefy mamas. All of them.
All of them. All of them. I don't even care. Give them to me. All of them.
How do you like it?
Yes.
Before we wrap things up, I want to ask your guys' opinion on one final thing. I know he was in the Fatal 4-Way to determine the number one contender. He won the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. How long do they push Bronson Reed before he gets swept aside like all the other Andre the Memorial Battle Royal winners?
So I've noticed he's been eating shit forever. I mean, that just might be me paying attention slowly. Like, is it me or is he losing like all the matches he's in?
I think you're right.
Okay. So like if wrestling's right, you eat the shit to get put back at the top, right?
Right.
Because you do it for that. So I'm wondering if we're going to get a push somewhere.
I hope so. I think he deserves it.
This might be one of the guys the draft really propels. Get him on a different show, fresh matchups.
Logan Paul, Matt? What if that's the next U.S. title type? Like, what if they're, you know, pushing some? I mean, that could rocket him.
I'm totally fine with that. I mean, they need to make him the beast he was in NXT again.
Yes.
The guy can work. He's a big badass. Let's portray him as such, and let's have him start mowing down everybody.
Like, what happened? Exactly. Okay. Right where you just said, what if he would go in there and just dog walk Logan Paul in 3 minutes? Kiss my ass.
I wouldn't be against it.
No, I wouldn't either.
You would show that, like, you know, he's got to be tough to beat the... Granted, Logan Paul's... I mean, like I said, he's not built to be the tough guy. He's this little weasel shithead from the outside. Yeah, well, what if... It doesn't matter what you learn, dude. Boom, there's 3 minutes of your life I just took from you. And your belt. And your prime.
I would really like to see a feud with Bronson Reed and Kevin Owens. I think...
I have a crush on KO.
I know you do. That's why I said that. And then Bronson Reed, both those guys can work. Both those guys can kick the shit out of each other.
Can you imagine the super cannonball?
We're all going to win.
Yes. God, yes. Why don't we own a wrestling company?
Why don't we?
One of us, I think, does, don't they?
Don't you do that. Don't you?
Whoa, CZ, what do you want to tell us something you've been hiding, bro?
Maybe.
What the front door, my friend? Whoa, butt cheek on a stick, dude.
No. I'm just teasing. I'll be honest, I did own a wrestling company. Nick was a part of it. It was an e-fed. Does that count?
I'm in.
I mean, I'm a nerd, so
I'm in.
And I'm in no script to wrestle. I'll do everything online.
You've seen me in my wrestling gear, dude. Who loses 45 pounds since Christmas and is still fat? Me.
You got this, dude.
You look great. You looked great when we seen you up in Waterloo. You really did, man.
I appreciate that, guys. I've been grinding my ass off, so
you really look good, man.
Thank you.
Speaking of Waterloo, Absolute Pro Wrestling, tell us where we can find you in the next few weeks, Shank.
Bro, oh, OMG, LOL. So that's a little throwback for you guys. April 20, 420, for all you fellow 420ians. We are up in Algona. Your boy is actually in a, I don't know how I got wrapped up in this, but a six man, all the belts on the line ladder match. Me and the boy, Brycey J, with the tagging with Ethan Everhart, we're putting all three of our belts on the line against the Free World. I didn't sign up for that shit, but somehow we got volunteered. So
somebody signed you up for it.
Well, they talked shit, and I guess I wasn't in the meeting, but okay. Shank, we need you out there. I'm like, God, can we just take it? It's the fucking holidays.
I'm gonna steal a line from Prentice, and I think this six man ladder match can be a great match if done right.
I'm gonna stab that guy when I see him next. I'm gonna hurt him. I forgot how much I hated that guy. Jesus Christ.
Oh God.
If done right, it's crazy. It's been done right pretty well lately. Oh. So, okay, then we're going to the next weekend. We got the 27th. We're going to where the Shank is from. We're talking my home county, man, Hardin County. We'll be in Steamboat Rock. This venue means a lot to me because this is where the Shank was created. It's where I started cage fighting. So the same smell, that same bloody floor, that same lot. Like, I'm going to the event before with another with Victor Payne. Victor Payne used to be a cage fighter in the same building. So me and him are actually going to show up to the building early and probably most likely cry when we walk in and just smell the smell. Because the last time I was in there, I don't know why, I was walking around the town and the door was open. I walked in and I smelled the gym and I just turned around and walked out. It just gave me like PTSD. It's what I imagine like veterans smell like gunpowder. It's just, you know, because like I was a young kid, dude. I started 15 years old in there just getting beat. Fighting grown men, slinging fist and dick, man. Just trying. And so, you know. It gives me the shakes now just thinking about it, man. I love that fucking place, but man, does it smell different. But yeah, so we're there in Steamboat Rock. Me versus, well, hopefully if I win, I can keep my belt and take that with me in. But I got Jackson King, that little shit talking punk from the Free World. So he decided him and Captain Midnight were going to hang out. And I was like, you know what? Me and Jason Prentice have a date for you, boy. So yeah, the very next weekend. Yeah, as long as he don't take my gosh dang title, I'm gonna whoop his ass twice, two weekends in a row. And then right after that, May the 4th be with you. We're right back here in Waterloo, man, ready to tear the house down one more time. Hit 300 people, baby. How about it?
Good for you guys.
Thank you. I think what we do, which I'll toot my own horn, I think we do it better. And I can't say much. Okay, I'm going to take out the whole, what do you want to call that? The whole southeastern part of the state, eliminating two companies because we're too far apart where we don't really cross paths or butt up to each other. For the ones you know down there, you got your guys' area. But the rest that we play along with, that come along with us, the other three, I think we do storylines a lot better. I think we do people winning and losing are right. You know what I mean? We don't book for our ego. We book for the fans. I don't understand how since our first show at Waterloo, we've run what now? Like I think 10 or 11 shows in Waterloo and our numbers have gone up. We've never dipped below. We've always one up the next number. We're up to 300 now. You know, that's fucking nuts for us. And what if it turns and nobody even knows we're around still? It's so crazy. I had a lady today show me. She's like, oh, my friend posted wrestling show at the Sportbox. I'm like, they can't. Like, we literally have a contract with them. Yeah, she shows them my show. It's us from APW. And I'm like, you what? I'm like, damn. Like, and then, you know, I dropped mail off today at the ice cream shop. Like I said, I'm a mailman. I dropped mail off. My poster is still hanging up. I'm like, what?
Awesome.
It really is, what, man. It's guys, a team you effort.
Guys, you guys are doing good things. I'll tell you why. When CZ and I came up, we couldn't find a freaking parking spot for 10 to 15 minutes.
It was crazy. Side note, we're not going to say that's us because there was a hockey game going on across the street because we do have the Waterloo Blackhawks and they were playing.
It was you guys. I don't care.
It was you guys.
As I say, the parking lot, it was going on and there was parking spaces when I looked across at 5:30 there. There were still spaces there. So, and the doors opened at 6.
Anybody with an earshot of this, you get a chance to take in an absolute pro wrestling show. Please do so. You guys will absolutely love it. I know CZ has been to 2. That was my first one. It was great seeing you up there. If for anything, you get to watch Shank and all these little kids, these adoring kids line up and get their picture taken with the one, the Brandon the Shank Eubanks. Dude, it was really cool seeing you interact with all those little kids.
Bro, tell me that's not the longest line you've seen for at an indie show for a non-famous wrestler.
it was pretty good, man. It was pretty good.
It was all the way to the entrance. I just kept like, because like I said, I like looked up and I'm like, dude, holy Christ. Like, how many children are there? And they're just like, hey, Shank, hey, sign my shirt. And I'm like, sign my arm. And they're like, why? I'm like, because I'm your fan too. You're my fan. I'm your fan. Oh my God, dude. You just told those kids they're the greatest of all time. They're like, hey, sorry, it's bad, but my name's Leah. And I'm like, that's cool. It literally could be an L. We're going to whoop their ass the same. But that's what I love. So I'm getting Shank's fans. They're white t-shirts. I'll say Shank's fans. We're going to have all my fans sign them, and then I'm going to give them away after every show. Just throw them out to the crowd after a match.
That's a cool idea, man. I know the fans of Absolute Pro will absolutely eat that up for sure.
Oh, they're going to love it, dude. I almost want to create I almost want to have it where all the little kids can run up to the entryway and like put their arms out and like so everybody can hide. We used to do that when I was a cage fighting back in the day, but it was kind of weird because I was like 16 years old and some of these kids were like 12. And I'm like, y'all literally like 4 years younger than me. I don't get this. What? Why are you high fiving me? I'm literally we're about to be in high school together.
All right. Well, gentlemen, that's gonna put a bow on this episode here. Recapping night 2 and Raw after Mania here. Shank-A-Mania, if you will. Shank, thank you so much. Always a pleasure having you on the show. For my tag team partner, never wrong, Nick Bull. I am the Wizard CZ. Tune in back at our regular time on Sunday. We're doing something we've never done before because we're the podcast for the fans, by the fans. We're having a fan on. That's right. Our good friend Stryker is joining us.
Let's go.
It's going to be awesome. I'm excited.
I'm going to be in the comments, so get ready.
We'll bring it on.
We can't wait to see you, man. We can't wait to see you.
Following week, we've got Connor Hopkins coming on. I'm really stoked for that. And then to round out the month of April, we have Zach Abstract joining us. It's going to be a fun few weeks. Stay tuned to socials for anything new. Don't forget about May the 4th. Not only Absolute Pro Wrestling, but the Sandra Lee Memorial Car Show, the 3rd annual. We'll be having a presence there. Meet some famous wrestlers. Have some fun. And thank you very much. We'll see you next time right here on Card Subject to Change.